Well, good morning and welcome to our service this morning. It's great to have you here with us. Before we sing our first song, let's spend some time to still our hearts before the Lord. So let's spend a few moments in quiet and then I'll pray for us before we sing. So Lord, we still our hearts before you now. Holy Spirit, we ask you to fill our hearts, that we will be filled with the joy of the salvation of the Lord Jesus this morning, as we hear his word read to us, as we hear Tom preaching, as we sing praises to your name. Lord, we ask that you would fill us with joy and that our eyes would be open to see your glory. And we pray that in the name of the Lord Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. So now we're going to sing our first song. Psalm 106 tells us a story of the Israelites and the Exodus. And it tells us of the way that the Israelites kept sinning against God in the wilderness, but verse 8 has these wonderful words. Yet he saved them for his name's sake, to make his mighty power known. And we know that no matter how badly we've messed up, the Lord will forgive us because he is the forgiving God. And so, with that knowledge in mind, let's say the words of our confession together. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are the forgiving God and that you save us and forgive us for your name's sake. Thank you, Lord, that you can do that because of the death of the Lord Jesus on the cross for us. Thank you that he took every one of our sins, past, present, and future. So, Lord, please do restore us to the joy of your salvation, that we would know the joy of having all our sins forgiven. In Jesus' name, amen. So now we're going to hear from Jenny Tarbox, who's going to fill us in on how things are going at the Quetta Hospital over in Pakistan, which is one of the mission enterprises that we support as a church.
There you go. Well, wonderful to have you with us, Jenny. Thank you very much indeed for agreeing to come and do this interview representing Quetta Hospital. So could you just remind us and the church family a little bit about what they're doing over there?
Yes, certainly. Quetta Christian Hospital was set up in 1886 by a Christian missionary then to the Afghanistan and Iranian border. It has an excellent reputation because the Christians who work there have the Christian ethos of respect and honesty and kindness towards all their patients, rich and poor. Wow. So that's the background. We have, Burford Church have actually supported the hospital for the past 10 years.
Wonderful. Thanks very much for that, Jenny. And how's life been for them over the last few months then?
It is always difficult. Things are not easy in Pakistan at all, but it's been particularly difficult because they were one of the first places in Pakistan to be hit by COVID-19. This is because they're close to the Iranian border, and Iranian pilgrims poured back into Pakistan. And although they tried to shut the doors, they all arrived in the outpatients department suffering from COVID-19. The hospital has had to be shut on two occasions for deep cleaning. They haven't been able to, until recently, to get any PPE. Even if they tried the blackest of black markets, they couldn't. And one of their senior superintendents in the hospital herself became very ill with the virus early on. And of course, she was heading up and managing other staff. She's been off sick for a long time, but fortunately is now making a good recovery.
Great. Thanks very much for that. And are there any particular challenges that you've heard from them that we can be thinking about?
Yes, there are. Really, since towards the end of last year, they found they were having very great difficulty receiving funds from such as us in our church family and other organisations. All their funds come from Friends of Quetta Hospital UK, which is a charity based obviously in the UK, and all their funding was stopped. This is nothing to do with the hospital, but the Pakistan government suddenly put an embargo on almost all NGOs receiving any funds. So a particular need is they're going through the long, complicated process of getting accredited with the government and registered. It actually means applying to 14 different Pakistani government departments in Islamabad. And that is challenging. It's a tremendous amount of delicate paperwork and delicate negotiation. That is because if they don't have the funds, there are times when they can't pay their Christian staff. They can't subsidize the treatment of the people who are too poor to pay. They can't maintain or buy vital equipment. It is a hospital that's particularly well known for a very, very good obstetrics department. Do save a lot of lives of mums and babies. So in that particular area. So that is a great need that they're working on.
Yeah, no small challenge there. Wow, poor things. And so what can we specifically be praying for then, apart from the obvious?
Yes, obviously that, to pray for that, for much needed funds to be able to flow smoothly through, and to pray in general for the safety of the staff and their families, not only because of the virus, but always ongoing, well before the virus. It is a dangerous place to be as a Christian, a dangerous place to live, a dangerous place to work, even though, yes, it's a Christian hospital, but it suffers like the rest of the Christians do in Pakistan. So yes, for the families, for the staff, and for their general safety and well-being.
Well, thank you so much, Jenny. Let's just pray for them now, before
end
the interview.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you for this time. Thank you for the update from Jenny, and we thank you and praise you that your gospel has spread all over the world, even to places like Pakistan. And we thank you so much for the Quetta Hospital, for the wonderful light it is for you and your grace in that place, Lord, the way they wonderfully serve anybody who comes to them, which is a wonderful witness to you, Lord. And we have heard what an incredibly challenging time it is for them. And so, Lord, we ask for your mighty blessing on all of them, Lord. We ask for safety from the virus and from the persecution of Christians that goes on in that country. And we ask for, please, Lord, an opening of doors in terms of managing to fill in all this paperwork and getting their status as an NGO and being able to receive funding again, Lord, that they would be able to do that vital work in saving lives, in bringing health and in witnessing to you. So we lift our wonderful brothers and sisters over there in Quetta Hospital up to you, Lord, and ask for your mighty blessing on them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much, Jenny. Thanks for joining us.
So before Pauline reads to us from the next part of Exodus, let's pray. So, Lord, we ask that you would open our eyes to see wonderful things out of your law. Please, Lord, open the eyes of our hearts to see your glory. May we be receptive to your word this morning. And as a result of what we hear, may we love the Lord Jesus more deeply. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Our reading this morning is Exodus chapter 32. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered round Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol, cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterwards, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people, whom you brought up out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol, cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation." But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "O Lord," he said, "why should your anger burn against your people whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce anger Relent and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. Moses turned and went down the mountain with the two tablets of the testimony in his hands. They were inscribed on both sides, front and back. The tablets were the work of God. The writing was the writing of God, engraved on the tablets. When Joshua heard the noise of the people shouting, he said to Moses, "There is the sound of war in the camp." Moses replied, "It is not the sound of victory. It is not the sound of defeat. It is the sound of singing that I hear." When Moses approached the camp and saw the calf and the dancing, his anger burned and he threw the tablets out of his hands, breaking them to pieces at the foot of the mountain. And he took the calf they had made and burned it in the fire. Then he ground it to powder, scattered it on the water, and made the Israelites drink it. He said to Aaron, "What did these people do to you that you led them into such great sin?" "Do not be angry, my lord," Aaron answered. "You know how prone these people are to evil. They said to me, 'Make us gods who will go before us.' As for this fellow Moses, who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." So I told them, "Whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off." Then they gave me the gold and I threw it into the fire, and out came this calf. Moses saw that the people were running wild and that Aaron had let them get out of control and so become a laughingstock to their enemies. So he stood at the entrance to the camp and said, "Whoever is for the Lord, come to me." And all the Levites rallied to him. Then he said to them, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Each man strap a sword to his side. Go back and forth through the camp from one end to the other, each killing his brother and friend and neighbor." The Levites did as Moses commanded, and that day about 3,000 of the people died. Then Moses said,
"You have been set apart to the Lord today, for you were against your own sons and brothers, and he has blessed you this day." The next day Moses said to the people, "You have committed a great sin, but now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." So Moses went back to the Lord and said, "Oh, what a great sin these people have committed. They have made themselves gods of gold, but now please forgive their sin. But if not, then blot me out of the book you have written." The Lord replies to Moses, "Whoever has sinned against me, I'll blot out of my book. Now go, lead the people to the place I spoke of, and my angel will go before you. However, when the time comes for me to punish, I will punish them for their sin." And the Lord struck the people with a plague because of what they did with the calf Aaron had made.
Have you ever had a relationship that has effectively totally broken down? It could be for a variety of reasons. It could just be drifting apart, or it could have been something that you or they did. Longing to get back together, to have peace and for that to be restored. Well, that's the case for God's people here in Exodus 32. They'll get to the point where they're longing for that relationship to be restored because they are no longer at peace. Why? Because as Exodus 32 shows us, they fail to worship him as they ought to do. Instead, they bow down to a golden calf. It's a story that's known to many. And so let's just think about it for a few moments and think, why was it that they ended up doing this? Well, we see it in verse 1, when the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain. Then at the end of verse 1, they say, "As for this fellow Moses, we don't know what's happened to him." Moses is a long time. They don't know what's happened, and they're afraid. So they mob Aaron to find them somebody else. It's a lesson they should have learned by now, though. to trust God. At the Red Sea, what do they do? Well, they panicked. What do they do when they ran out of food and water? They panicked. When the Amalekite army came, they panicked. And yet God provided each and every time. They just needed to trust and to be patient. Yet as I say that about them, I think of myself and I think I should learn that lesson too. God can be so generous and kind, provide so much, show incredible love towards me, and yet how quickly, as soon as some difficulty comes along, I can throw my arms up in the air and go, oh, where is God in this? I know I'm not alone in doing that. And it reminds me that I need to trust God. He has shown so much evidence of his faithfulness and goodness. I just need to trust him and recognize that he's not necessarily working in my way, because his is better, or in my time, because again, his timing is better. Well, the description of the sin is, of course, they make this golden calf. Now, I don't think it's a denial, that I don't think they're denying that God is their rescuer. What do they want? They want one who's going to mediate for them, like Moses had done. So how do they do that? Well, a golden calf. But before we get too critical and think, gosh, how primitive and stupid are they? Actually, it doesn't look that bad to begin with, because it starts with a gold gift offering. I mean, incredibly generous gifts. And they announce a festival to the Lord, which in chapters 4 to 7 was going to be the great aim of and being set free, to have a festival to the Lord. And they get up early, which shows significant devotion. And they offer burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. This looks incredibly religious. And then Aaron says, verse 4, these are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt. I mean, they aren't stupid. They know that this golden cow isn't the thing that rescued them, but it's a symbol to help them remember the God that did. So actually, maybe it's not as bad as we first thought. It's helping to remember God. They're being very religious in the way they worship. Where's the harm? Well, clearly there is harm, because God really hates it, and we'll see that in a moment. But what is the problem? Well, it's a breach of commandment too, particularly about making idols. But why is that such a problem? It is because, I suppose, this is an earthly representation of what God is like. It's saying God is like this. Now, bulls, calves, they symbolize great power and strength, particularly in a place like Egypt. Their gods were of power and strength, and it was important in cosmology. It was a very pagan symbol for power and strength of God. And of course, when you're alone, in a desert, and afraid, that is exactly what you want. But here's the problem. God is not a cow. God is so much more than that. You see, God had defeated all of the gods of Egypt, and they're turning back to a false, defeated gods of paganism. God might have power, but that's not all he is. He's also a God of faithfulness, of love and mercy, and it's a good job he is, because otherwise they're going to get wiped out. And that isn't symbolized by a cow. But actually, what do they need? They needed instead Aaron to remind them who God was. Exodus 1 to 30 are chapters full of the character and nature of God. It's about a God who sees, who hears, who knows, and sends someone to rescue them. It's about a God who sees and does great works of power to rescue them from the Egyptians. He's provided food for them. He's given them a tabernacle, which is what chapters 24 and 31 are all about, so that he can be with them. They've seen all of that. They've seen his trustworthiness, his reliability, his power, his generosity, his kindness. And they reject it. They rebel against him and reject it. It's a total denial of what God is like. And the result of their false view of God, their false worship of that God, is revelry and riot. Verse 6, they get up, present these offerings, and then they eat, drink, and get up to indulge in revelry. Or in verse 25, it looks very much like a riot. And I say that when you have a wrong view of God, you worship him the wrong way, and it quickly becomes increasingly vulgar to him. And so it is a drunken orgy at the end of this. But of course, what do we expect? You see, how you think about God does affect how you live and therefore worship. And in turn, how you live and worship affects how you think. You see, they get who God is wrong, which means they end up getting the how to worship him wrong. And the result is godless lives. The pagan representation that says that God is only about power results in a pagan worship and sex unfaithfulness and total lack of self-control. But the sin of the calf is so very easily ours. And by ours, I'm not saying ours as a nation, because of course this is the people of God who do this, and therefore this is seen in the church today. And we need to be wary of it. That actually, as God's people, as the church today, we can so easily pick up this sin of the cow. How? Because we end up with a false view of God. And a false view of God leads to a life that is not honouring to God. It does not worship him as we ought. How we think about God affects the way we live. I'll give three examples, and let me be clear. No one believes these things truly, but we all have aspects of them at different times. So, for example, we can consider God to be distant and removed. And in some respects, like Israel, away and therefore not help. And so the result is that not all of life will end up being about worshipping God, because we need to determine our own lives, because he's too far away, that we become semi-gods. And therefore our lives become characterized by fear and worry, because we've got to try and control it all. And where we can't, we despair. That's if we think that God is far away. The result is, I suppose, that we can, in order to control things, we therefore hoard things. We become materialists, would be one way in which we express it, because it's all about making sure that we can cover everything and care for everything. You see, what we view of God affects how we live. Or we view God as a judge. You know, the sort of the only there to catch you out sort of thing. He's like the deputy head that I had at school, Mr. Hartley, lovely man really, but he was always around the corner just when you didn't need him to be. So the motivation of serving God is fear, not love. So you don't want a relationship with him, and you serve hard in order to justify yourself, to satisfy God. And so we end up becoming self-righteous. We don't do things for the sake of others, but actually to please ourselves and to hopefully please God. And then we often see it that when the way in which we thought we were serving God gets taken away, we can get very angry or very nervous. Because actually that was the thing that was giving us our identity, our purpose, our value, our justification before God. That's if we view God as a judge, just a judge. But the other end of the spectrum, I suppose, is when we think that God is there really kind of as a nice friend, a sort of more of a therapist, someone to chat to and just help me feel a bit better. So he's there to satisfy me, which removes the fact that he is king and lord. And so my ethic becomes, as long as it doesn't hurt anybody, then it's all okay. And if it does hurt somebody or it does hurt me, it must be stopped. So relationships end up being based on how I feel and mutual consent, not on what God says is best. So if I consider something not to be what I want, then I don't have to listen. Which means actually God's word is going to end up being quite uncomfortable for us. So we'll say it's outdated. It becomes irrelevant. Because God doesn't know what 21st century Britain's like. He can't possibly have meant it, because he must want me to be happy, nice, and feel great. And so all of us step aside from the teaching of Jesus that says that actually we need to take up our cross and follow him. That the Christian life is one of sacrifice. And just as what they needed was not to go finding some other God to worship, or finding some picture or caricature of God, they need to be reminded who God really was. And that's all we need to do too, to find God in his word. So the sin was that they made God an image in their own mind, thinking of him in a way other than he truly was, and therefore by worshipping him in a different way too. So is there any hope? Well, we will see that God shows mercy to them and shows mercy to us. But in the meantime, we're going to just spend a few moments reflecting. As we listen to the song, "Our sins, they are many, but his mercy is more."
Would wait as we constantly roam. What father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood beneath a debt we could never afford. They are men, his mercy is more. So much more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new evermore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord.
Israel have sinned, and they have sinned badly, haven't they? Well, what is the result of this rebellion and rejection? Well, we see God's anger. Verse 10, "Now leave me alone, so that my anger may burn against them, that I may destroy them, and then I will make you a great nation." God says it's time to start again, and it is deserved. And it produces Moses with an incredible opportunity that he could be the great nation. And yet Moses isn't concerned in the slightest about that. Not a bit. Instead, he's concerned supremely for God's glory, for God's honor and reputation. And so what Moses does is, in order to preserve God's glory, he does three things. He intercedes for the people. He disciplines the people that God's glory might be maintained and honored. And then he seeks atonement, that he may be glorified as his people are once again restored with God. So how does he intercede? Verses 11 and to 14. Well, there's something here for us. He doesn't intercede by sweeping under the carpet or excusing their sin. No, he appeals to God's own reputation. Verse 11, why is it that these Egyptians should say, verse 12, that it was with evil intent that he brought them out? Turn from your fierce anger. He doesn't want the Egyptians and others looking on to go, oh, God is evil. No, he can't afford to wipe them out. But secondly, he's concerned for God's glory and says, look, you are most glorious when you are faithful. So verses 13 to 14, he says, remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self. That is, this phrase, swore by your own self, takes us back to Genesis 15, where God promises on oath to fulfill his promises to Abraham, and then Isaac and Jacob. It's an odd ceremony where animals are cut in half, put either side of a path, and God walks through the middle, as if to say, if I break my promise, which we know he won't, then you can tear me apart from limb from limb. The covenant is all of God's work and he will keep it. And Moses knows that God cannot destroy his people because of the promise he made, because he's always trustworthy and faithful. That is why he's so glorious. And see how different Moses' response therefore is to Israel. Israel are worried and afraid. They wonder where Moses is, so they make stuff up about God. But what does Moses do? He remembers how glorious God is, his faithfulness. And that is what gives Moses great confidence to speak and speak to God in the way that he does, to intercede for them. Now, where we see the church go astray, on what basis is it that we appeal to God? What is my motivation? Is it for the survival of my denomination? Is it for that or for the glory of God? Is it about the survival of buildings and our position as the state church, or the glory of God? Is it about the survival of our position within society, or the glory of God? What God has promised is that his glory will be seen as he builds his church, but he hasn't promised necessarily to build the Church of England. We must pray for the Church of England. We must pray for the church in England. But supremely, we must pray for the glory of God to be known in the world. Because God will keep his promise and he will build his church. So let us pray that God will build his church in the world. But God is also most glorious when we see the discipline. The discipline that Moses, the interceder, the leader, the mediator, does. He comes down from the mountain having appealed for mercy. He then gets angry with the people. And I hope you see those two side by side, mercy and wrath. Discipline is those two things. Moses can't come down the mountain and not care how they've just behaved. So he takes the calf, he grinds it down, he makes the people drink the dust of gold. It's a symbolic thing of total destruction, annihilation of the idol, teaching something very important. And yet, and given this must have taken some time, there is still revelry going on in the camp. And so a judgment must be delivered. The Levites come to his side and 3,000 are killed because they refuse to repent. Moses interceded, asking them to repent. But still, there were some who were unrepentant, and so the judgment came. Now, where we feel this is a bit over the top, I just wonder whether we've made an idol of God in our minds. It's to say that sin isn't really a problem, that maybe God is not justly angry at our sin, and that actually he's over the top in his reaction here. Well, that's to say that God isn't bothered by holiness. No, so what we need to remember is that the wages of sin is death, and the people of Israel collect their wages. What's staggering is that 99.85% of them don't. So Moses, concerned for God's glory, he intercedes for them. But then he brings about discipline to to teach them. And then finally, God's glory is seen as he seeks to make atonement for the people of God. Verse 30, Moses says to the people, "You've committed a great sin, but now I'll go up to the Lord and perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." He wants them to be at one-ment again. Because sin is not just an arbitrary making of some rules. We see in verses 15 and 16 stresses how many times that it's God who wrote the law with his finger. It's an expression of who he is, and they just smash it up and tear it apart. Just think of a child who spends hours on a painting and gives it to you, and you just rip it up. There would be a broken relationship, and there is a broken relationship between God and his people. They need to be brought back to God, and Moses knows that, and he offers to be the mediator. He offers to make atonement. Now, of course, Moses in chapters 24 to 31 has been told all about the sacrificial system. But there's a hint here that Moses knows that that wouldn't be sufficient. Because in verse 32 he says, "Now forgive their sin, but if not, then blot me out from the book that you have written." Here Moses offers himself in the place of God's people. They have rejected him, and yet he was willing to give his life for theirs. Now you'll see in verse 35 that God does not accept that offer. Because as we know, Moses is not able to. He might be willing, but is unable. But it does point us to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is not only willing, but also able. You see, for the sin that we have committed, where we have rejected him, where we have worshipped other gods, so Jesus offers to stand in our place. You see, he seeks God's glory as he says, "Yet not my will, but your will be done." He prays for the people of God, "O Jerusalem, how I've longed to gather to you." He would discipline the people by bringing warnings of judgment on their religious system of his day. And supremely, his glory is as he's lifted up on the cross to take the curse of sin on himself. He would stand in my place and your place so that we can be forgiven and go free. Yes, 1 Corinthians 10 tells us that these things are written as a warning to us, not to be proud and think that we couldn't possibly ever be like this. Yet Romans 8 tells us this: "Who then is the one that condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was then raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is interceding for us." Where we have sinned individually, where we have sinned as the people of God, so we have the Lord Jesus Christ, who intercedes for us, who disciplines us, and who supreme on the cross makes atonement for us, that we need no longer be at war with God, be enemies with God, but might have peace with God. Brothers and sisters, keep yourselves from idols. But we have one who intercedes for us, one who has mediated on our behalf to bring atonement, that we might be at peace with God. We're going to reflect on that as we sing together, "The Power of the Cross." Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross.
Written on your face, bearing the and this the power.
Together. Dear loving Father, we thank you that you have called us to be members of your family here in Burford and throughout the world. Together with the countless numbers of the communion of saints through the ages. Though we have not been able to meet together as we should wish, our identity as your children, as part of your family, has never been in doubt as we place ourselves and each other under your loving care. We thank you for the many instances of kindness from members of our church family who have actively and prayerfully sought out those more vulnerable and perhaps living alone during the corona pandemic. We thank you too for the thoughtfulness and careful planning of our town council, setting in motion measures to alleviate the problems of those in the town who might feel isolated. May the love and care initiated during this lockdown be of lasting benefit, generating mutual understanding and appreciation in the town. Father, we remember those of your family whom we may never see or know in other parts of the world, who face persecution and physical attack, where the prevailing culture is hostile to your kingdom. Please protect these brothers and sisters in Christ and those you have chosen to minister to these churches. We ask you to be with the McLean family, starting service with Crosslinks in West Africa. Please help them and their three children to settle in well in their new surroundings. Fill them with love for those you hope to serve, and please help them with the language study. May they grow closer together as a family as they face this new challenge. And dear loving Father, we pray for those in this country who labour to make known the saving grace of your Son, particularly those working in areas of our city least reached by your gospel. These men and women known to you, who seek to build up a relationship with communities of varied ethnic origin, where the name of our Saviour is only heard maybe as a swear word. Please, Father, encourage these ministers, give them stamina for the task and love for those they seek to reach with the love of Jesus. May they not be weary in well-doing, but see lasting fruit for their work. Father, we thank you for our Queen, for her faithful example of selfless duty and service to this nation. Please protect and encourage her in her daily walk with you. We ask you to guide those chosen to govern over us. Please give them wise judgment and sensitive foresight with decisions made to further the common good. Please inspire and encourage all who work to find an effective vaccine for the coronavirus. We thank you for the cooperation among scientists of many nations. Prosper their work, we pray, and bring it to a speedy fruition. And dear Father, we pray for our country at this period of great change, bringing hardship to many with the loss of employment, the cost of which will be borne by our grandchildren for many years to come, the burden of debt and the upheaval that Brexit will inevitably cause mean that turbulent times may lie ahead. Whatever the coming days may bring, help us to remember that you are sovereign over all things, our rock and our fortress. And help us together to walk closely with you. And let us pray for our team ministry and Tom Wilding, who has just joined us to help the work with the youth, striving to find new and relevant ways to communicate the source and the joy of a Christian life, yet maybe denied personal contact to do so. Thank you for the technology enabling them to pray together and prepare services. Give them wisdom and patience, and unite them in your Son, so that they and their families may be strong and equipped to fulfill the work you have called them to do. Now let us sum up our prayers in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
So we're now going to sing our final song, To God Be the Glory, which speaks of the wonderful redemption that we have through the blood of the Lord Jesus, the perfect forgiveness and redemption of all our sins. Let's sing together. So let's pray before we end our time together this morning, and then I will finish with the words of the blessing of Aaron from the book of Numbers. So Lord, we thank you that despite our great sin, you are faithful to forgive us. Lord, we thank you for the Lord Jesus who stands before you, Lord, who is our mediator. Because of his blood, we are completely forgiven. And Lord, we thank you so much for the great love you have shown us, the great salvation that you prepared all the way through the Old Testament, leading up to the wonderful, wonderful salvation that we have in the Lord Jesus. So please send us out this week, Lord, to praise his name, to live for his glory, and to bring others to know the wonderful salvation that we have in him. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.